It's moderated by Bronwyn Fryer, who is a journalist. She wrote the article Sex in the Superhighway and working in the April issue of Working Woman on women in the computing industry. And with that, I will turn it over to her.
Sandy pointed out to me at lunch that if this were an all-male group, this panel would be called the executive option. Which gives us all some food for thought. On that we can digest. I'm probably one of the very few non-computer scientists in the room and probably the only non-scientist in the room. I saw Karen Frankel's video last night, which was rather amazing to me because her work and mine are very similar. We're sort of, as journalists, outside observers of all of you. And the topic of women in the computing industry has become very, very hot as of late. Some of you may have seen a Newsweek article recently. There was a series of articles in the Wall Street Journal. There was my article. And Karen Frankel's work, all of a sudden, everybody's very interested in all of you. I don't know. You may have some explanation for yourselves, and we can talk about this at this panel, but I must tell you how honored I am to be here with all of you. It was wonderful of Telly to invite me here to moderate this panel. And one of the reasons I suspect that she asked me to moderate it is because I talked to many of the people here at the conference in researching the article, and I did, some of you who are on Sisters may remember that I posted some interview questions, and some of you responded to those. So thank you very much for helping me with the research for that. And I also have to tell you how my major was comparative literature. I did most of my doctoral work in comparative literature, and that's a female-dominated field. So I must tell you that I can imagine how lonesome you must get sometimes if you're all in, you know, your math classes or your computing science classes and you're the only woman. I have to tell you that, you know, after hearing your stories, I really do admire you very much. It turns out that my research kind of corresponded to other things that we've heard yesterday and Karen Frankel's research that bachelor's degrees, the number of bachelor's degrees awarded to women in computing science is going down. Apparently it was 36 in 1992, 36%, as high as 36. And it's going down to about 30% in 1994, they're expecting, and the number is still continuing to drop. Why that is, nobody really knows. The number of graduate degrees is also, it seems to have leveled off somewhere around, what, 12%, something like that. And then faculty positions are around 8%. This was a little disturbing if you think that those numbers haven't really significantly changed over the long period of time. And in technology companies, in industry, the situation is worse. That middle management positions are held by about 20% of middle management is held by women. 10% of senior management, and that's an optimistic figure, and only 2.5% of board positions are held by women in hardware and software firms. And that last figure is particularly distressing because board positions is where the power is, as Sandy pointed out, also at lunch. Congratulations, by the way, go to Lotus Development Corporation, which last month finally appointed a woman to its board of directors. It's very disturbing because as the San Jose Mercury News, which is the largest newspaper in Silicon Valley, pointed out that women are 10 times more likely to be represented on the Supreme Court than on the average board of directors in Silicon Valley. And that includes biotechnology companies. So it's a bad situation out there. Now, why it is, nobody really knows as well. There may be a conspiracy of white males. The same old white males that are also sitting on those boards. And that's probably true to some degree. Well, also, the thing that I noticed in interviewing, I did something like, how many interviews? 62 interviews in 2 weeks. After talking to so many of you, there is a pervasive belief that the high technology industry, I'm talking hardware and software, is comparatively gender blind. especially among women. And that is because it's a fairly young industry, probably. But Bill Gates is what, only 39? He's younger than me. But somehow there's this belief that because it's a young industry, it's also gender blind. And women particularly not only believe this, but want to believe it. Women, the women I talk to are inordinately optimistic about the position of women in industry. And it runs a little counter to the experience of people who have been in the industry for a long time. So, I don't know. There are a lot of women who aren't opting for management positions. This may be because women don't want to work 80-hour weeks, as is often required in startup companies. They may not be as aggressive as the guys. Carol Bartz pointed out to me that if she were evaluating a man and a woman for the same job, it's likely that the man will say, I'm the right guy for the job, and the woman will say, I think I can do that. And who are you going to hire, right? So if that's the case, it is really the issue of self-confidence more than anything else that is holding women back. Perhaps. I don't know. Anyway, I had also worked in some software companies in marketing positions, which tend to be more dominated by women. But I noticed even in those positions that I held that role models were few and far between, women role models particularly. And today, I'm very proud to introduce four people who are role models for all of us. No matter what capacity we serve in. These are women who have achieved not management positions, executive positions, and who are very powerful in their companies. And these are people that we can all look to, no matter what we do, for direction and as people who can help guide us perhaps through the potholes of our careers. And so it's my pleasure to introduce to you Sandy Lerner, Helen Bradley, Paula Hawthorne, and Don Gilbert. What we'll do is each of the panelists will speak in turn, and I'm going to ask you to hold your questions till the end of all the discussions. And then we'll open the floor to questions. There will be a generous time period for questions. And when you do ask your questions, please direct them to the individual speakers, because that rather than a generalized question to the panel, so we know who to direct that to. The first speaker, I suppose I could just go down the row. Our first speaker will be Sandy Lerner. Many of you may know Sandy as co-founder of Cisco Systems. If you're not familiar with Cisco Systems, I couldn't remember whether it was a local area networking company or a wide area networking company. It turns out to be the latter. And she opted out of Cisco. She became too big a company, and she's a born entrepreneur, so she left the company in 1990, and now is doing a variety of things, which she'll tell you about. But she lives downwind from Bill Gates, and in a state where she doesn't have to pay income tax, which makes sense. I give you Sandy Lerner.
I have 5 minutes to tell you why I'm up here. I'll take 5 seconds. I don't know. It's probably because when Tella Whitney was doing this, I said, you know, you're kind of missing something in this program. There's, you know, like academics are like okay, but that's not where the money is. I have expensive habits. Actually, they cut my two expensive habits out of the picture in the thing. Tella Whitney goes, give me a really interesting picture. And so like there's this whole picture of my pea-brained head and my two huge horses, and they cut the horses out, and I'm miserable. I sort of came at this back-asswards. I actually have an undergraduate degree in comparative communist theory. I'm probably the worst example of a capitalist up here. Well, you know, at least I quit before Fidel did. It looked as though I could probably get an academic job. In fact, I think I was probably a pretty good political scientist. Unfortunately, I probably couldn't get much of a salary at that point. So I decided that the computer facility was really the way to go. And so my first year in graduate school, I I decided to interact very closely with the computers, and within a few months was managing the computer facility and went on to do that for Stanford University Schlumberger Computer-Aided Systems Laboratory and the rest of it. It's not a very good living. I've spent almost 20 years in a business that makes me very much afraid of the telephone. I have deep psychological scars about telephones, which fortunately doesn't work with my car phone now, and that's, if you want to get me, you have to use the car phone. Founding Cisco was not kind of what you think it is. I noticed that my colleagues on the other end here have had very different experiences. We went through 70 or 80 venture capital firms before Cisco finally got money in its third year. Our company was started in our living room. It's now a $6 or $7 billion company with like 1,500 people. I don't work there. It's $14.99. Alice doesn't live there anymore. We didn't get funding, I think, for some fairly good reasons. Nobody wanted open architectures. TCP/IP was not a proprietary technology, and of course you couldn't make money with a standard. You had to invent something weird and then keep everybody else from using it. My co-founder, Len, is a little strange. If you know him, I think people think he gets hair on his palms at night, but he's a charming man in my estimation. I also think that because I very clearly had my hands on the reins, that none of the venture boys were going to touch this with a 10-foot pole. In fact, I was told once by one of them who didn't invest that as long as I was in the company, we would never get money. Is this industry gender blind? NFW. No way. And after our company took money in its third year, and by the way, just a little statistic, we finally got venture funding when we were shipping $500,000 of product a month with no sales force over the internet. This is a venture deal. Have people around the block for that venture deal, right? Since we have taken funding, there have been no women on the boards of directors. The number of women reporting in the executive staff has declined to zero. This is a successful company, right? And a company started by a woman. It's habitually in trouble with the equal opportunity people. Even in the count of Silicon Valley, it's pathetic, the number of women managers. So I guess my one message to all of you people out there, and this is not my original thought, but if you're going to go out in business, it helps if you start your own company, but I got fired from my own company, so it's not an answer. That's probably the one ticket into an executive position. It's certainly not the only one, but it's more sure than many. It's not safe when you're there, and you really do have to work twice as hard and be twice as smart. Other than that, I mean, it's a piece of cake.
Boy, that's a hard act to follow, Helen. Thanks.
Thanks a lot.
And the good news is, Helen Bradley, if you have read about Helen in your booklet, you've read that she was vice president of software engineering at Sunsoft, the subsidiary of Sun Microsystems. Unfortunately, that was the case before the booklet went to print, so Helen being hard to pin down as usual, decided to shift gears shortly after she sent in that descriptor. And so she is now in charge of engineering and support at OpenVision, which is a startup company based in Pleasanton, California, but Helen flies hither and yon all the time. That develops system management applications for client-server environments. And she told me, she gave me some of the best quotes from my Working Woman article, which is probably why she ended up ending the Working Woman article. But one of my favorites was that she told me that when she was at MIT in the 70s, her professors told her that she should go home and have babies. And so it pissed her off enough to make her, you know, want to prove to him that she could be both a woman and in charge of Solaris. So she did that. On that note, please welcome Helen Bradley.
Thanks for the introduction. Actually, I guess I went to Open Vision because they are a company that has a woman on the board of directors. So hearing the statistics, I'm pretty proud to be part of them. I can't really quite compete with getting into engineering because of political science. I got into engineering because I was far too short to be a professional dancer. And I like to make things, and you could make a lot more money making computers than you could making pottery. So MIT was a good choice. They didn't have locker rooms for women, so you didn't have to take PE. They didn't have any requirements for English or history, so you could take things like contemporary moral issues instead. So off to MIT I went, and yes, they told me I'd never succeed in engineering, that I should go home and have babies. I've done pretty well in engineering. I don't have any children. I give MIT as much money as I make off of having babies. I got my degree in math at MIT. Following that, I went to Georgia Tech, where I got my degree in computer science. As far as my background as an engineer, I've worked at the IBM Cambridge Scientific Center, where I did research in the 70s, some early research on relational databases. I spent a number of years as an engineer at Bell Laboratories. I was part of the team that did the first implementation of a microprocessor-based Unix system, and I was also the architect of their 32-bit processor, the WeCo 32000. So somehow I ended up in management, and I think this session is kind of, why do some of us engineers go to the dark side and become one of them? Very early on in my career, I seemed to gravitate toward being the project lead on the projects. I had lots of ideas about what kind of things needed to be done, what sort of things you could do with technology. People came to me with ideas. I gave them ideas. They went away and did it. They came back. I gave them more ideas. They were successful. They kept doing things. I led them around. I liked it. So the natural thing as I came along was to move into management. I enjoyed the aspects of leading teams and the impact that I had, much broader impact than just designing my piece of code. And I never gave up the love for really liking the technology. After Bell Labs, I was director of telecommunications for Squibb Corporation. I ran their voice and data networks in the US and all their international locations. They covered about 35 countries. From there, I went to Pyramid Technology, where I was director of networking. I went from there to Sun. I was director of networking there. I was director of OS. And I became vice president of their system software organization. So why did I end up going into management? I liked the technology. I never really saw myself, though, moving up and becoming vice president in an organization. I was certainly given advice not to do that. One fine person that I didn't work for him, he was several levels above me, did give me the advice that unless I corrected my severe personality disorders, I never was going to make it in management. That gave me a lot of encouragement that I could succeed. Actually, it's become a strength. I've used it more as a strength. I'm just odd. I really didn't want to become like the VPs that I saw at the time. I mean, they all fit a mold. I thought they all must go to the same store to buy their little VP suits. They were really disconnected from the technology, from the engineers, from what it takes to get a product out the door. I remember one of them who was trying to lead the organization into rewriting Unix in assembly language. He was convinced that that was the only way to get performance tuning out of Unix. I think a lot of us have done pretty well. Fortunately, he got promoted to executive VP, so the world was a safer place and we liked it. I hope I haven't become a VP like that. To me, managing engineering organizations is still about engineering. Engineering to me is developing products that people want and people need and people like to use. That's why I went into engineering. I like to build things. I get a thrill every time the product goes out the door. The other aspect of engineering that is also a thrill on the management side, there's another product I develop, and that's my organization. It's every bit as much engineered. It requires creativity, it requires design work, it requires logical thinking, it requires good judgment. It's like building a system to me. So the product that I leave behind when I go to another company is something that I'm very proud of. As far as myself moving up in management, I really never went through setting my sights on becoming a vice president. I never actually went through setting my sights on, I want that position. Position doesn't mean much to me. It's not something that motivates me. I'm motivated by a good challenge. I'm motivated by responsibility. I'm motivated by technology. I've always focused myself on doing something where I'm learning something, because you can ignore me at meetings, you can harass me, you can treat me like a second-class citizen, but you can never take away from me what I know. As a result, people are willing to pay for what I know, and that's how I've ended up moving up in management. So I know that I can get good products out the door, get hot technology out the door fast, and I know that I can build an organization of really top-notch engineers who like to work there and like to get products out the door. Those are real skills that, no matter what happens in a company, I still have. So I go with the highest bidder. I go for the money and I go for the opportunity. And I guess that has a lot to do with why I recently went to a new position. So bottom line for me, the management option, the executive option, it's still about engineering. I don't think all good engineers become good managers, but I do believe that the best managers are good engineers, and I believe the very best managers are female engineers.
Thank you, Helen. I'm pleased now to introduce Paula Hawthorne, who's Vice President of Engineering at a company that has also just switched its name. A lot of switching going on here. She is at Illustra Information Technologies, which was formerly Montage Software. Is that in Oakland? Oakland, California. Barbara Simons has described Paula as having had the worst childhood she ever heard of. I didn't ask any details, but I know from having had an iffy childhood myself that it makes you tough. If you don't succumb, you become very tough. And that strength is very good for women. So she's probably a living statement. She also, she also had an interesting experience with her graduate advisor at Berkeley, who rather than telling her to go home and have babies, told her to get rid of her babies when he found out that she had two young children and was a single parent, which she didn't do. She didn't follow his advice. She managed to raise her two children and get her PhD and also become one of the preeminent women in engineering. So please welcome Paula Hawthorne.
I have to clarify, I mean, that is an absolutely true story, but it wasn't Mike Stonebreaker. Mike Stonebreaker was my thesis advisor. It was my major field advisor, whose name is Alan Smith. And anyone who knows AJ, right, knows that it was absolutely typical. And it was a landmark experience. I arrived on the Berkeley campus. I found where he was, which was an adventure in itself. I got there. I was 30 years old. I was going back to school to get my PhD, and I was so glad to have actually gotten there on campus, all the way from Texas, in a U-Haul at trailer that said adventure and moving on the back. But anyway, and then the first thing he said was, if we had known that you are a single parent, we would never have accepted you. Being a graduate student at Berkeley is a full-time profession. You may not do anything else, and there is no way that you can get through this university. We have great enrollment pressure on us. We have 100 applicants for every one position. You're taking one of those positions. You've got to get rid of those kids. Won't your ex-husband take them back? And I, of course, went, well, I'll ask. Well, gosh, I guess I'll try to find out. So what do you do with this? So what do you do with this, right? And that's one of the things I want to talk about, is what do you do about these things that happen to us? That was one of the things when we were watching Minerva's Machine last night, is that we wanted to say, okay, now what do you do next? What I did next was to get angry. Getting angry is very good for me because it's energy that I harness to keep me awake long enough to do my homework at night. You know, it's energy that I can use. The anger, you can, you know, people ask me, well, should I think about going into management because, you know, there is this glass ceiling. I actually have never experienced it as a glass ceiling. To me, it's more like there was a short story that Kurt Vonnegut wrote a long time ago about a society where everyone was forced to be equal by having different impediments, like this wonderful dancer had to wear big iron shoes, and the scientist had to have this loud music all the time in her ears. And to me, the discrimination against us women is a loud noise. It's always there. It's always with you. It's not a glass ceiling you bump against. It's just always there. So what do you do about it? There are some women who are very good at not hearing it. See, I know about this because I had these two boys who are now two grown men who learned to not hear things, you know? I mean, you can not hear something. You know, and there are women who have learned to not hear it. And I'm not going to knock those women. I honestly believe that not hearing it can be advantageous. I have been with friends of mine who are the people who don't hear. And the two of us will hear one of these remarks. And I'll say, can you believe he said that? And she'll say, oh, he was just kidding. He didn't mean it. You know, you're too sensitive, Paula. You take things too seriously. And that's okay up to a point. And that point is when you start internalizing, well, gosh, it must be me then. You know, if those people are thinking I'm incompetent, well, maybe I really am. So at some point, there has to be a balance. You have to hear it. But what do you do with it when you hear it? If you dwell on it, if you say, every single thing that happens to me is because I'm a woman, then you never grow, because you have to learn. You have to take criticism. You have to learn. So part of what I did at Berkeley and part of what I've done forever is to hear this, but to try to not take it personally. You know, I can laugh about AJ. I actually walked out of the office and laughed about AJ, you know, because he was so clearly not in the real world, you know, and still isn't. But anyway, the whole issue about how you deal with discrimination is personal. It's personal for each one of you. And my only real message around it is, it isn't going to be any different. It isn't going to be any different if you open a spaghetti restaurant, which is one of my goals in life. It isn't going to be any different. It's always going to be there. And so you might as well have a lot of fun doing what it is that you want to do, and just learn to live with it, to use it, to harness it. Now, I have an incredible amount of fun doing what I'm doing. It is one of those situations where I have worked for a very long time. We're nearing on my 30th anniversary of having written my first computer program. and I have been in this field for a long time, and I have managed to work into a position where I'm now vice president of engineering for a startup. This is a company which is commercializing a research project. The research project is Postgres, which was done at the University of California at Berkeley. Mike Stonebreaker was my advisor 15, 18, how long ago, Barbara, 17 years ago. But anyway, so I kept in touch with Mike, and when he told me that he was starting up a company to commercialize Postgres and said, do you want to be vice president of engineering? I was at the time head of operating systems research at HP Labs, and I thought for about 5 nanoseconds and said, yeah. And the reason for the short time there is that to be able to be in charge of your own engineering organization is a really neat thing. And it's neat for reasons that have just been expressed, but also it's neat because you can move so fast. You can move so fast, and you can be so close to the customers. You can get the products that they need out to them. In this position, so there's Mike Stonebreaker, who's starting up this company. And Mike has a track record. He helped start Ingress. Until just recently, that was seen as a success. And there were venture capitalists who were quite willing to back him. However, when we went out for our second round of funding, we were opening it up to more VCs. And there was a little problem about me. And I began to understand that there was a little problem about me because there would be these sort of little objections. Can Paula be tough enough? Does Paula have the technical expertise? These are code words. These mean, Paula's a woman. And it's not even just, it's not just the way that I look. If you read Deborah Tannen's book, You Just Don't Understand, and you ought to read that book, I am the stereotypical woman in that book. I do all that stuff. I say, well, this might be right, when what I really mean is, God damn it, this is right. I do all of those things, and therefore, I sometimes come across as not knowing what I'm talking about. And the way that we got around this finally is that Stonebreaker would introduce me. This is Paula Hawthorne. I've known her for 15 years. She's a technical genius, right? And it was sort of neat, and we managed to pull it off. The other part of that is that I am very good. That's one of the things that I think is most interesting about this job. It is a very hard job, and anyone who thinks that you don't have to be absolutely on top of technical details when you are a vice president of a startup is just naive. You don't get any mistakes. In a startup, you get zero mistakes. And therefore, you have to have the vice president of engineering who really knows the technology and who knows it cold and who knows it in her sleep. And therefore, it is a challenge in every way possible. It is an incredibly interesting and important job, and I love it. And I want to encourage all of you to go into management. There is a lot that's said bad about management, but there is this guy who used to be a radio news reporter in San Francisco, Scoop Nisker, who said, if you don't like the news, go out and make some of your own. And that's why you go into management.
Thank you, Paula. Our final panelist is Don Gilbert. Don bears an extraordinarily long title: America's Sales Vice President of Multi-Vendor Customer Services at Digital Equipment Corporation. I'd like to try to say that in German, but it would be much longer. She's been at Digital for 18 years, and as such, you can look to Paula as somebody who has been at a big company for a long time. What does somebody who's been in a big company for a long time have to say? So we're about to find out. She also impresses her secretary with her inordinate energy. Her secretary chases her down the hall to try to talk to her. And she also recently moved to the Northeast, and she hates it
hates the winters there. I guess she got clobbered by snow the first winter that she had there. And she has a great sense of timing. She just arrived about an hour ago. With that, please welcome Don Gilbert.
Thank you. I had the impression that Bronwyn might start out by telling you that I'm at least one member of this panel that wound up in this position because I was unemployable as a teacher. And that's absolutely true. I think sometimes that we planfully build steps in our careers, and I think at other times we fall into, or trip into wonderful opportunities. And my career is certainly a combination of being planful and maybe lucky, having some of those good opportunities to trip into things. When I graduated from high school, I was really perplexed about what I wanted to study, because I had two great loves, French and physics. And they're common. What led me into the field of French turned out to be my first experience with mentorship. I didn't know the word. I didn't know what mentorship was about. But my high school French teacher took time to help me learn about good language schools. He wrote letters of recommendation for me with my applications to these schools. He sponsored the work that I did in trying to obtain scholarship money, because I didn't have any money to go to college. And as I look back, I learned an important lesson from him that today I think we call mentorship. I learned something when I graduated from college, too. I learned about gender bias in the workforce, and I learned it from women. I couldn't find a job teaching French, and so I went to a placement agency. And I talked with them about the fact that I would like to employ them to help me find a job. And the very first thing I had to do before they would take my money was take a typing test. Right? Ooh. Now, I was 21, graduated cum laude, spent a year traveling and living in Europe and studying. I thought I was pretty hot. I couldn't type. And the jobs they wanted to send me out to interview for were things like assistant to the general manager at the pool store. And I would talk with my friends. I'd say, what's wrong with this picture? These are women. These are women running this placement agency. They haven't got a clue. What I identify with and the picture that's in my mind of the kind of work I want to do and the kind of professional that I want to be. It wasn't personal.
Was it?
It wasn't personal. It's just that that was their frame of reference. They had no idea what to do with me. So I went out to find my own job, and I got lucky. See, it was long enough ago that there were not hordes of unemployed comp sci majors hanging around on every corner. There just weren't. It was kind of like comp sci what? And the gentleman that hired me at NCR as a programmer trainee believed that people with language backgrounds and music backgrounds made excellent candidates for programmers. Me. They paid me $500 a month to teach me to program a computer. I was on cloud nine. I thought it was all the money in the world, and they were going to pay me. I just got done paying through college, you know? They were going to pay me to teach me to do something that I didn't know how to do. Wow. What a wonderful world. I spent about 8 or 10 years of my career in the software field as a programmer and as a systems analyst. But as I did more and more work with customers, I began to understand something that Sandy talked about. I go on a sales call with the salesman. They all were, you know. And we'd be talking with the customer, and the customer spent more time talking with me than they did with the salesman. I think it had something to do with technical credibility, with integrity. I learned that I could make more money by selling the computers, but I didn't have to give up the technical integrity that was important to me as a software person. And it helped me to build a very successful sales career because I was able to retain that. And I had the credibility of my customer because I never gave up that integrity. I think women, by and large, have a tremendous amount of integrity in terms of the way that they want to do their work, regardless of what that work is. And I would urge you to hold on to that integrity in anything that you do, whether it's technical, whether you move into management, whether you're selling, designing, whatever you're doing. That integrity is something that will help you stand apart from the average individual doing the work. The other thing I figured out is that it's good to take risks. You know, I've been at digital for a long time, and that may seem like a pretty safe place to be. Used to be. But one of the things that people note about my career is that I did a lot of things that weren't necessarily safe. I knew that I wanted to be close to the money. That's why I got into selling. I knew that I wanted to be close to the customers because they're the people that really, really do count. But I also like to do different things. So whenever there was a special project, you know, a new venture, something that's slightly you know, outside the nine dots or off the curve, I'll try it, I'll do it. And I think it really broadened me, and I think it gave me visibility perhaps in you know, corridors of the company that I might not have had any visibility with if I just sort of, you know, kept my head down and kept selling and kept doing PDP-11s and faxes and stuff. So I would encourage you to take some risks from time to time. It's okay to try something different. In closing, I think that sisterhood is not really something that was in my mind when I decided that I wanted to manage. In fact, I'm pretty sure it wasn't. I think growing my own career, having a bigger canvas to paint on, being able to influence a broader base of customers than I could as an individual sales professional. Those were some of the kinds of things that were in my mind when I decided I wanted to get into management. But let me tell you, now that I'm there, there is nothing that is any more satisfying for me than seeing a young woman or a person of color in my organization make a dramatic improvement in their performance or a dramatic leap in their career. It is such a wonderful feeling, you can't even believe it. So I find that while my womanness and sisterhood were not really things that were compelling around moving me to this place in my career, they are absolutely a part of what I do every day and a part of the joy that I get out of managing at this level in a company. So you can take it with you. We don't have to leave it behind. That's it.
Okay, we'll take questions. Oh, this is your opportunity. Come on. Yes.
Hi, I'm Bonnie Heights from Indiana University, and I have a question for Paula and possibly Dawn. I work in a computing organization that supports the entire university, and most of our managers have come up through the technical ranks. And previously to our current new administrator, promotions to management have been seen as a reward, not as a responsibility. And most of our managers can't manage their way out of a paper bag. And you know, obviously what Dawn said about really caring about the people that work for you and their ability to improve themselves is, I think, what makes is the key to making a good manager. So what do you do when an organization is filled with people who got to management because they're technically very competent, and they still are very technically competent, but really can't manage? Thank you.
Quit. You know, my answer almost always to what do I do when I'm in this totally incompetent organization is get out of it. Get out of it as fast as you can. Because you as an individual are not going to be able to change that very much. If you have incompetent management, you don't have a cost structure, you don't have an evaluation structure which is in place which will catch those incompetent managers. And it's flawed, and you should start thinking about getting into other areas. I never advocate a person from down below trying to change a whole organization above. I know there are people who will disagree with me, but I personally think that's a windmill situation. That's a very hard thing to do. And instead I say, start networking, start talking to your friends, start trying to find a well-run organization. There are well-run organizations. That one doesn't sound like one.
A comment and a question about money and power and women. The comment is that about the glass ceiling idea. I've been under a great deal of pressure for the past 5 years to go into management roles. And since I prefer designing user interfaces to counting money, I had always felt that I would like to stay on this side of the glass ceiling, especially when I looked up through the glass ceiling and saw who was there. Because I really don't like, you know, I'm exactly the opposite of the typical Deborah Tannen woman, in fact. And my husband is really annoyed with me because of that, because I don't give him sympathy, I give him explanations, you know. But I would like to earn more money eventually, because I'd love to be able to allow him to quit his job and do what he really wants to do, which is create. But my question is really concerning money and power. And how that how that can make your life as a woman easier. sorry, it's not what you think I'm going to say. I was at Sun Microsystems. I believe I can say this without fear. Now I'm gone. And I belonged to a focus group on women's diversity issues. And in fact, I was working for a female manager in the human interface engineering group, and it was a 50-50 men-women situation. All the guys were sensitive new age guys. They were charming to work with. We had absolutely no problems with them at all. But notice where we were. We were in human interface engineering. We had no executive power. We had no budget. If you went into away from our area in technical land, there were fewer women and more distrust of of women's technical capacity. If you got as far as sales, the tales that we heard from our sales force about outright, blatant, disgusting sexual harassment shocked me to the core. Because I didn't think that kind of thing went on anymore. And I think that the fact that that level of aggression and hostility existed was to do exactly with that's where the money is. That's where the power is in the organization, too, because it's invariably from the sales force that you draw your executives. So in a sense, what I need is some advice on, perhaps from I've forgotten your name, I'm terribly sorry.
I'm Dawn.
Dawn. On how to overcome my repugnance of what I see when I look through the glass ceiling.
This is something I think they can all address.
I don't think you should try to overcome your repugnance at all. And if what you see is not acceptable to you, and it's not something that you want to be party to, and you think that there are norms of behavior that are expected of you, then go away. I don't do that. I didn't have that same experience. I guess I've been very, very fortunate, but I've worked for a series of very supportive, nurturing kinds of managers in my career, all of them male, and they have invested in me and in the skills that I think I now have and bring to my organization. So as I looked upward, if you will, in my organization, I saw some things that I didn't like, but I didn't have to do them either. Okay, I mean, I just really did not have to participate in that. I didn't have to learn to play softball. Yeah, I mean, that was a criteria for a while. If you were going to be a manager in this one organization that I was party to, you had to be about 6'2", pretty good looking, and you had to play softball. I'm sorry, I don't qualify. But as I looked up, you know, to each level of management above me, and maybe I couldn't see very far. Maybe I could only see, you know, one or two levels of management at a time. I felt encouraged by what I saw, not repelled by what I saw. And if I had been, then I would have gone away. Anybody else want to comment on that?
I was actually interviewed for the Newsweek article, and they took one, you know, five words, and it wasn't what I was trying to say. What I was trying to say was, I personally have had various incidents of sexual harassment, like everyone, but I also have had very good things, like you, very good things. I had a mentor and my master's program. First of all, I had a father who loved my talent for mathematics, who thought it was wonderful. I had a mentor in my master's program. I had a mentor in my PhD program. I have worked for a series of people who have been very good. Part of that later is I learned to look for the men who have strong wives, who have strong daughters. I tend to look for these people. I tend to look for women, but I don't find a lot of them to work for. And my point to the Newsweek reporter, which she absolutely ignored, is that one reason there are so few women in our area is that there are so few of these uniformly good kinds of experiences. And what we have to do is to educate people to get more of these uniformly good kinds of experiences. That's, I think, important too. We know that we're fortunate and that not everyone has had the same experience. We feel very lucky.
I'd like to address this because I'm starting to feel I'm the only one in the world who hasn't worked for a supportive manager. I've spent most of my life working for assholes. Some of them are even known in the industry to be assholes. So not everyone has had wonderful supporting mentors or people that they want to model themselves after. If anything, it's motivated me to change things. It's shown me what not to do in life. And like I had said before, I go for what I'm learning from the job. So if that means working for someone I don't like, the primary thing for me is doing something where I'm learning how to do something.
I'm Sally Unger. I manage software engineering at Sun. I've been managing for 6 years. And in the last year, I got a rather brutal education in office politics. And I noticed two behaviors of the men that I worked with. One that really, I didn't know, I guess I should have known about this before, but I really didn't. And one of them was that a man in private will say an awful lot of things, and they'll express strong feelings or whatever, but if you get them in a meeting where you're supposed to be like solving a problem together or addressing an issue, they all of a sudden get silent. And they all of a sudden like have this reluctance to directly address the issue and solve the problem. Another one is that they could like totally destroy someone professionally and then turn around and joke with them about sports or cars or something and have just a jolly good conversation. And my question for basically everybody on the panel is, do I have to learn how to do that?
I think the answer is no. Women come with a couple of tremendous disabilities. We don't play sports as children, and we don't learn how to be team players. You're here because basically you've made an individual effort. There are no mentors out there to a first order approximation. It's very easy to succeed in business if you play golf, if you can drink like a fish, swear like a truck driver, and you're crazy about anything that happens to be on the ESPN channel. Okay. There's a lot of support for that out there, and I will tell you, having been in the bars, attempted to figure out what season it was, I cannot play golf. And I can't drink. It's very, very difficult, but the one thing that you do have to do, and this is the one thing I think that we've alluded to here but really missed, you have to be a team player. Women don't know how to do that. You're talking about taking a situation in a meeting, shortest distance between two points is still a straight line. The reason why the men aren't saying anything is because to do that is not being a team player. And I have seen people come and I've seen people go, starting the Soviet Politburo. The team players win. People who give the appearance of being a supportive, good person, okay, it doesn't say you are a supportive, good person. I haven't found anybody in a sales organization yet who qualifies. But you can give the appearance of being on that team, and you know that's where all that stuff comes from, you know, the golf and the softball. I am a hell of a softball player. I'm a terrible team player. The one message that I would give to you guys about glass ceilings and the rest of it is keep your eye on the ball. What is important? The company is important. The mission is important. The bottom line is important. The profitability is important. Your salary is important. Your job is important. The team is important. Be a team player. You will keep your job. You will get a better salary. Everybody will like you. You don't have to compromise your ethics, and you don't have to play golf or drink.
Do you want to add to that?
I think it summed it up.
I have an additional question. I mean, what exactly is a team player in your definition?
You should read Games Your Mother Never Taught You. Mm-hmm. Every woman should read Games Your Mother Never Taught You. I tried to find it in the bookstore to give it to a friend, and I think it's out of print.
Oh, great.
But who wrote it? Who's got? Betsy Harrigan. And she really defines, you know, the whole team aspect. Now I interrupted you. But if you
the first thing to being a team player is that you can't distinguish yourself and you can't be threatening. Because you are female, you are distinguished and you are threatening. You just can't focus on it. I mean, there's a lot about being female, I think, that gives us a lot of really good skills, gives us some advantages. There's just a lot, it's like being a person of color. I mean, you just are what you are, and that's the way it is. And you can't focus on it outwardly. I think it's crucial that you focus on it inwardly. But you can't be visible. You can't be visible being visible, which is, you know, you have to kind of appear to fade back in the background, and you can't be threatening. If you're very bright, you're very young, and you're very female, this is a tough order. Okay, it's not easy. And the only thing I can say is watch the guys. They're very good at it. And you know, you diffuse situations by talking about basketball. You diffuse situations by establishing pecking orders and relationships on a golf course. And we just don't have that option. And in hindsight, having been fired from my own company, that was my biggest mistake. I was not a good team player. I'm still not a good team player. And you just, it's going to be a lot harder for you, okay? And there aren't, I'm glad these women have had mentors. I'm agreeing. I mean, I've worked for assholes. Try not to be threatening. Now, that doesn't mean try not to be stupid. You know, try not to be stupid or try to fade in the woodwork. But you need to do it in a collegial, positive way and keeping your integrity. What's anybody going to argue with?
My name's Rayona Sharpneck, and among other things, I'm a former professional softball player. No, I don't play golf. One comment that I got from the head of the Women's Sports Foundation that I found really fascinating was that when they did research on girls and boys as team players, what they found is that in elementary and junior high school, where girls are playing sports more now than ever, when they looked to see in the selection process of picking teams, boys always picked the best kid in the school, the best athlete in the school on their team. Girls always picked their best friend. So, you know, I think there's something to be said for there's a different mindset that women select from than men do, but I would just encourage you to really take credit for the fact that you are team players. It just looks different than it does from another worldview. The question I had for the panelists, which, because I'm presenting tomorrow on women leadership in the future, is asking you to share with us what you consider to be the distinctive competencies of leadership. You know, what is it, aside from the technical expertise, that you would attribute as being the most effective and distinctive competencies of leadership, both you know, in a technical environment as well as in the nonprofit sector that Sandy might be involved in now? What do you see as those competencies?
I was actually thinking about, you know, 10 million things to say at this panel, and one of the things that I wanted to share with you is that it's only been in the last 3 or 4 years that I believe there is a future. You know, I'm a child who grew up during the 50s. I was born in 43, and I always thought that there wasn't going to be a future, that we would all die in atomic bomb blasts. And now I'm really thinking there will be a year 3000. And to me, that's just amazing. And it has been an amazing sort of mindset, in that there is going to be a future. And what is important? I think that's a very important question. What kinds of leadership do we need to take us to that future? To me, the most important thing to do is to really look at where we are very clearly, to have that clear vision of where we are, and then to extrapolate from that, not to try to build this castle in the air that isn't grounded in reality. So I think that these issues around national information infrastructure kinds of access issues are very clearly a part of the kind of vision people need, the kind of vision which is based in where are we, where are we going, what kind of world do we want in the year 3000, how do we get there now?
I want to go back to a word that's real important to me, and I used it in my opening remarks, and that's integrity. I think one of the things that clearly differentiates sort of a run-of-the-mill manager, if you will, from an individual that has real leadership in an organization is this integrity thing. If you are absolutely honest with yourself to the best of your ability, absolutely honest with your organization, with your customers and with the people who work for you, I think that's an important aspect of leadership. And clear direction, a sense of clear direction, and being able to clearly
articulate that direction to other people so that they can embrace it and begin to share your understanding of what that future state or future goal of an organization looks like is an important piece of leadership. And I happen to think that caring, truly caring about the business, about the people who make the business run, about the success of the enterprise, and having that just truly a part of your consciousness is also a very important part of leadership, and for me an important part of honesty as well.
I think an important part of leadership is having people who are going to follow you. you know, if you're running an engineering organization and you tend to be staying on the bleeding edge of technology, basically you're taking people on an adventure. And it's pretty important to know what's going to really motivate those folks on the adventure. So I could start a tour group going to a safari, and I could describe it as we're going to get on a plane and we're going to sit there for hours and it's going to be really disgusting and you're going to have diarrhea when you get there. Or I could talk about what it's going to be like when we get there and how exciting it's going to be and we're going to see all kinds of animals and it's going to be way cool. And if that's where people want to go, I can get them excited about getting there. Not only can I get them excited about getting there, but I got to get them to help me pack the bags to get there. So I view it as trying to take people on an adventure.
I'm Nathan McGovern. I'm a student at Carnegie Mellon University. And as I was listening to your opening remarks, I haven't heard it so much in the past few remarks. It's making me uncomfortable because it seems like you're talking about, I hate the word, but male bashing, like the men are no good. And it seems to me that the celebration of women should be that we're equals.
And this may be a generational gap, but I haven't experienced any of the things you're talking about. And so the men I know see me as equal, and I don't understand this. I mean, I understand it, but I don't like it. Just want to make a comment, not a question.
I want to ask you a question. And pardon my asking you this, but how old are you? You're 19. How many people are 20 years or under in this room? How many of those who are 20 years and under agree with what Amy has just said? Okay. And how many of those who are older than 20 also agree with Amy? Okay. And how many of those who are older than 20 feel that they have encountered sexism somewhere in their careers? So what I think you've addressed a very important issue, which is there is a definite generational experience here. People such as Dawn and Paula, who entered their careers all these women are older than 20.
Geriatric.
What's important, I think, is very critical to this whole discussion is that. And something that Dawn has just said is that there's going to be a year 3000, and you're a very important part of that. And it's very wonderful to hear what you just said, because if in fact you haven't encountered a problem, I pray to God that you never encounter one and that things are really changing. Does anybody want to add to this discussion?
Can I just add one thing?
Yeah.
I have seen things changing. Also, my sons are 25 and 24. They certainly don't talk about women in the ways that women were talked about many years ago. The men that I manage, people who've had babies in the last couple of years, that's how old the company is, the men will very often be at home with the baby. The men will be taking responsibility. There are changes going on. There are changes going on not as fast as some of us would like. There are changes going on not as well integrated into some of our lives, but there are changes going on. And men are a part of that. I think The word male bashing is something that I personally don't agree with. I think that we can name discrimination without saying that we are accusing every single man of doing that. We can name the things that have happened to us without being accused in reverse of dwelling on the negative. We have to name our experiences. We have to tell our stories. And if the stories for other people are wonderful, then that is wonderful.
Would you want to add something to that?
Yeah. I just wanted to say that I think I went to a school where people were very supportive as an undergraduate, and I would have tended to agree with Amy a couple of years ago. But I think as you go out, things become a lot more cutthroat, and I've had to struggle really hard to stay in grad school. And that is when that's when you become aware of all these issues. It's not when people are really supportive and where people give you the confidence to think you can do things. So I just wanted to add something to that. Just to tell her that maybe you should be careful later on.
Which is why we're here. Yes.
My name is Rhonda Livingston, and I'm a system administrator for Sun Microsystems. I should have had plenty of experience with invisibility. Not only am I a woman of color and Jewish, but I'm also gay. That would automatically make most people think, let's stay away from that one. Fortunately, that hasn't been my experience. However, I did have the unique experience a few years ago of managing someone who accused me of discrimination because he was a straight white male.
Wow.
And because he wasn't doing his job. So. Naturally, the fact that I called him on this instead of promoting him was exceedingly unusual behavior and sufficient reason for him to make this accusation. He had to protect himself. My question actually is regarding your managerial skills. How did you attain them? Because certainly nothing in any of my training taught me to look for something like this.
Can you direct your question to one of the panelists to start?
Sure. Since this happened to me at Digital, Don, I'm going to stick you with it.
Well, I don't know whether other companies are doing a better job than Digital is in terms of helping to groom managers and really build managerial skills, but that's something that I don't think Digital does well at all. And I don't know anybody at Digital that would disagree with me. And I think it's a very fair kind of statement to make. Years ago, and we really did try to assist people from an educational point of view in really developing their own skills. And I think as a company, we've gotten further and further away from that. In terms of just continuing to invest in myself, I continued to go to school. I continued to pursue management courses. Digital paid for some of that. Digital didn't pay for some of that. But I felt that that was something that I needed to do, I wanted to do in terms of growing myself as a professional manager. Mentoring is also an important part of that. I watched other people manage, and I saw what they did that I thought was successful, and I sure saw what they did that I thought was not successful. So from everybody that I worked for and from as many people as I could possibly observe, I learned things that I admired and that I wanted to be able to incorporate into my management style, and I very clearly identified things that I thought were deleterious and harmful in the organization and things that I did not want to emulate in my own management style. So both formally and informally, I would say I've tried to continue to invest to be a better and better manager all the time.
Nina Bhatti, and I'm a doctoral student at the University of Arizona. I have one quick comment to make and then one question. And my comment is about the woman who was under 20, Amy. And what I'd like to say is that I don't know that you'd encounter any discrimination necessarily unless you're in your first professional position, till you're in your first company. I mean, being a student with a bunch of other students who are male and your same age, I don't know that you're going to encounter it. I think when you go out in the world, when you're vying for positions against them, when you're competing with them, that's when you might come across some of this stuff. When you're all just students in classes, it may not be as evident. My question is, in regards to increasing the number of women in management, and the question is, there are many women, not as many as we'd like, but a lot of women with doctorates or masters, and my concern is that academic institutions tend to want to create academics. We are losing a lot of women, I think, who would be very good in management roles because academics want to train academics. And there's almost, I know my university, and I've heard this from other people, there's almost an anti-management, anti-industry. Forget management. I mean, maybe you can go in industry, but for heaven's sakes, do research. You know, don't soil yourself with management. And I think it's a concern because I worked for a few years, and I can appreciate what good management can do for technology and what bad management can do. And I'd like to hear if you have any comments about maybe trying to do something about that, because I think there's a huge education gap between industry and academia, and they rarely meet.
And so how do we bridge that? That's been a real problem. When I was at HP Labs, I actually, when I took the position there, read everything I could on technology transfer, how you really do this, how you really bridge this. We learned a lot from Japan and how they bridge that, and that is by having a lot of interlocking positions, people who are working both at universities and within the manufacturing industries, actually getting products out, actually understanding the challenges there. We don't have that here yet, and perhaps it's something along those lines. I don't think there's an easy answer to that problem. I absolutely agree that there is in many institutions a sort of a, it's like I was introduced to one person from not Berkeley, a lesser school, and you know, so the person shook my hand and said, oh, I'm so glad to meet someone from the commercial sector, and I had this feeling like, oh yeah, you know. No, I mean, it exists, and I think it is not a good thing, and having a PhD, by the way, I think was very important for me in moving into management roles because you have to know so much. The comment has already been made. I'm paid because of what I know. And getting a PhD was how I got to where what I know. That's when I was able to full-time, except of course with the kids, concentrate on learning. And I think having a PhD was, doing that was an absolutely great thing for me to do, and I recommend that to other women as well. And it doesn't mean you do a PhD and you don't go into management. You do both. The comma PhD on my business card gets a lot of credibility.
I'd like to find a microphone that works. I want to address the other side of that, which is I worked in academics for a long time. I was at Stanford Business School for years. And I noticed with what facility the men on the faculty of the business school moved in and out of industry. They could stay in their ivory tower, make a ton of money on the side consulting, and there was this wonderful network thing that was going on. And you know, like somebody would come up and have a problem, they would know just the guy to solve it. Okay, and you'd go out and you'd have a lucrative consulting contract, you'd get this like real kind of stamp of legitimacy for having, you know, your hands on the pulse of the real world, and you'd still keep your chair. Conversely, you know, you were out in industry and you'd come back and you'd give a session at the executive program, you know, at the Stanford Graduate School of Business. And hey, we missed the boat utterly. We don't network. We don't take our relationships and our friendships with us. We go out into the cold, cruel world by ourselves. You know, it's the drinking and the golf thing again. When you get out there, whether you've got a PhD or whether you get out and you've got a salary, right, remember the women that you worked with. Remember their strengths, remember their fields of interest, remember their names. And let's start to do this a little bit better. This is not man bashing, this is man envy at this point. Right? And they do it in a very positive way, and they manage to cross those barriers. I'm not saying we as a culture or we as a technology player anymore, it's in the States, are terrifically good at moving technology out of the universities. I'm speaking to a business issue, which is, you know, the men don't have to make that choice. Okay, I think we're put as women in an artificial situation where we feel this kind of, I don't know if I want to go do that and, you know, defile myself with industry and the rest of it. They're not making that choice. They're making a career. They're making a network. They're making contacts. They're making money. And hey, if it works for them, it'll work for us.
I guess I just want to add one final comment to that, is that I was in academics for a long time as well, and I found out when I went to work that being in industry, the other kind of work, that it's different. It's just as challenging. It's financially much more rewarding, which is why I did it in the first place. But it's also, there's just as much challenge and just as much opportunity and more fun than academia. So it's certainly worthwhile to consider. And for those of you, and I can't speak as a computer scientist, but I'm just saying as a longtime former academic that it's very difficult to make that transition. It was almost traumatic for me to decide not to be a researcher. But having made the decision, I would never go back. There's just no way. Oh, sorry, it's time's up. For those of you who do have additional questions, though, I'm sure that we can meet out in the hall and you can get to talk to some of the people on the panel. Thank you all for coming.